Hey everyone, and welcome to The Commons. Thanks for joining us for another virtual service. And wherever you are watching service today, maybe it's on your couch at home, maybe it's on your phone in your bed, or out camping, or kids running around and distracting you, we just hope this service can be a place of peace and that you can just feel God's presence in whatever way that looks like for you today. We're going to open by reading a piece from today's liturgy. This is the collect for today. O God, the King of Glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send us your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
As I rise, strength of God, go before, lift me up. As I wake,
Heavenly Father, you always amaze me. Let your kingdom come in my world and in my life. You give me the food I need to live through the day. And forgive me as I forgive the people that wrong me. Lead me far from temptation. Deliver me from the evil one. I look out the window, birds are composing. Not a note is out of tune, or out of place. Walk to stare at the flowers, better dressed than any girl on a wedding day. So why should I worry? Why do I freak out? God knows what I need. You know what I need. You're
Commons family, welcome to my office again this week. Thank you, Kyle and Greta, for that beautiful music. We're going to pray for another church in town. That's a big part of what we're about at the Commons, is praying for our family and siblings all around this town and the world. because we love them. And so today we're going to pray for Living Christ Lutheran Church here in Flagstaff and their pastor, Kurt. So if you're the praying type, join me and we're going to pray for them before we open up the scriptures. God, thank you for this time that we gather together. Thank you that in you we are connected even when we are not physically present. And Lord, we're praying for all of those who call Living Christ Lutheran home. And thank you for Kurt and his life and his mission for you. Thank you for all of our siblings that meet there. We ask that you let them know how much they're loved by us and by you, and always draw us closer to each other as we're going after you. And Lord, today as we talk about this series of Reconstruction, Lord, help us to open ourselves up to you, your love, your way, your kingdom. Thank you for grace and hope in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's very, very, very strange being downtown. And I'm sure many of you have been downtown in Flagstaff as the world seems to be reopening out of one of the most bizarre times of most of our lifetimes with coronavirus. I wanted to talk a little bit about our plan as a church, just so you know that we're not just winging it. We have been talking as a leadership team, as a staff, and I've also been really engaged with the entire community of pastors as we talk about the complicated idea of when we can start gathering together again. I know for many of you, you're probably anxious to do that, and not just about church, but life in general. And as the state opens up more and more things and businesses, and we're seeing restaurants and barbershops open and all those kinds of things, church is not going to be on the forefront of those things. Large gatherings of people together in an intimate setting is probably not something we want to rush out the gate with. And so churches are talking about different dates and phases of reopening, maybe community groups gathering. And we want you to know that we're going to keep you informed along the way, but we're not going to put people at risk just so we can hurry and be the first ones back. It might be the opposite of that. I read an article in the Washington Post this week about two churches that already opened and had to reclose as people got coronavirus in those congregations. And we're not gonna take those risks because we love you and care for you. And you guys have been so amazing in this online format. I told you last week, but again, I'm just so thankful for all the comments and shares and emails and interaction, your gifts for Fill the Truck, showing up. You've just been amazing. And we're doing okay. I can't wait to be together again. And I believe a day will come when we can hug and shake hands. But that day is not here yet, but we have our eye on the horizon and we're making plans and we'll keep you informed. I was thinking about for our Reconstruction series, this is the fifth and final week, and I wanted to use a quote from one of you online. We actually asked a question. I think we've announced a few times that we have an online community group on Facebook. Anybody can join. I think right now there's about 35-ish people that have found that. You can go to the Commons page and ask to join that. Anybody's welcome. And there's just discussions every week. People can post discussions or questions. But this week, Carrie Chamberlain posted a question about what would be one word you could use to describe your faith, especially in this kind of context of deconstruction and reconstruction. And I absolutely loved the responses of everyone. And then I asked the same question on some of my nightly videos. If you like the Commons on Facebook or follow on Instagram, I go live most nights for 8 to 10 minutes and ask questions. And one night I asked that question, and the one word answers that came in I thought were beautiful: metamorphosis, resurrection, transformation, complicated things. But the one that I wanted to read from the on the Commons community group was from Ken Collier. And this is what Ken said. Expanding was another word. Stretching was another word that came in. But Ken said, first bent, then shattered, then a bit of duct tape and a coat of cheap varnish for a very long time. More recently, a realization that what I have is beautiful, but very different from what I was originally sold. First of all, Ken Collier is terrible at following instructions. It was supposed to be one word, and so I definitely wanted to just call out Ken on that. But I actually loved what he wrote. In his describing his own faith journey, first bent, then shattered, deconstruction, duct tape, a veneer, kind of a fake expression, but then a deep realization that something about the faith he had is beautiful, but different from what he was originally sold. I really liked that. I thought that was really well said, in line for the discussion that we've been having about consumeristic Christianity. And if you've been with us for this five-week series, we've already talked about deconstructing and reconstructing the weirdness of Christian culture and consumerism. We've looked at the strange relationship of science and faith and what it's like to deconstruct an unhealthy relationship and what it's like to engage science as part of our faith. We looked at the dark side of the history of exclusion within the church and how a reconstructed faith is radical inclusion for all, church for everyone. And we talked about the disappointment and disillusionment of what's sold in faith, and we've talked about a much deeper connection. But today is going to be kind of, I actually kind of miniature crowdsourced the sermon because I had our staff meeting, our video call with our staff, and I said, how should we land this plane? What should I do the last message on? And Kyle Miller said that maybe we could focus this entire thing on the phrase of what's the point of faith. And Greta and Kerry Chamberlain had said similar things about, after all this deconstruction and reconstruction, what if we just looked at moving forward? What does it look like? What's the point? And I was thinking, in essence, it's kind of the so what of the entire series. If you've been around me for long, you know almost every sermon I end with a so what. Why does that matter for us today? And I kind of want to do that today in a strange and a little bit different format than usual. By kind of trying to sum up and inspire and maybe invite you into a deeper look of what faith could be like. Now, one of the things that I like, when I ask anyone about religion or faith in general, there's a general consensus. A lot of people would say that to sum it all up, or what's the point, or what's the significance of Christian faith or faith at all, one of the most common answers, and I like this answer, is that love is the bottom line. And when people tell me that, I first of all really affirm that, because 1 John 4 says God is love. And later it also says that whoever lives in love lives in God. I love sharing those passages from John, this friend of Jesus, because I think it's beautiful and deep, and you could really go a long way down the path of thinking about what those words mean. So this idea that God is love and whoever lives in love lives in God is a big universal idea, but also the idea that we are loved. I think of Romans 8, 38 and 39, for I'm convinced that neither life nor death, neither angels nor demons, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That was a passage that meant a lot to me in my younger life, and has not ceased to mean something deep for me, that nothing can separate me from the love of God. Life, death, angels, demon, height or depth, I love the poetry of that. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. So there's a very real sense in which I think that's the right answer, but we're actually not looking for answers today. That's kind of one of the takeaways that I hope that you'll find. And when people say love is my religion, I think, okay, I get that. That's cool. But what always runs through my mind is, for a lot of people, it sounds like they're saying this is the end of the story. For me, I came up with the answer, and the answer, the end of the question about love and meaning, religion and meaning, is love. And I just go, oh, that's not the end of the story. That's the beginning of the story. Love isn't the end of a question. Love is the very fabric from which the question is made. Love is the bass note. It's the music. It's the stuff that the story is written in. I don't even have the words, because there are no words to encapsulate something as big as love or God. And that's kind of the whole thing that I want to talk about to sum up what reconstructed faith looks like. And what I'm not going to do, one of the reasons I say that this is a little bit of a different version of a sermon, is every week I open up the Bible and I go through a specific scripture, either in the liturgical calendar or topical or in the season we're in, whatever it is. But today I'm just going to kind of vomit parts of this library of books we call the Bible. It will be very much like drinking from a fire hydrant, because I'm just going to kind of rapid fire things that come to my mind. And here's why I want to do that. I want to do something really weird. I started this series by using the analogy for deconstruction and reconstruction of taking apart a bike and looking at the parts you don't need and putting it back together. And I kind of want to now ask you to completely forget that analogy, which is super weird because it was my analogy. And I think it served its purpose to introduce this particular idea of reconstructing faith. But I think it's actually a really terrible analogy, and here's why. Something as big as faith or love or Christianity or church, It's too big to be put into a simple analogy of systematically putting something simple back together where you throw out the old parts as if they never existed, it didn't affect you. I mean, when we throw out things like systemic racism within the church or exclusion of women or horrible economic suppression of peoples all in the name of Christ or white supremacy, you kind of just can't throw those away and act like they were never there. That's too simple. And you certainly can't just simply put a bike back together. So what I want to do today, instead of giving an answer, instead of giving you a new systematic theology to understand Christianity, which is what pastors for thousands of years, 2,000 years, have attempted to do, is I want to actually lean on one of the tools of Christian faith, the Bible, in the fact that it is not systematic theology. It's a book of stories. It's a library of incredible stories about interactions with Jesus, about individual characters that come across Jesus, about entire nations and ethnicities and people groups and wars and famine and liberation and existentialism. It's too big to be contained. And so the new analogy I want to offer is, instead of a bike being taken apart and put together, is I think a lot of times deconstruction is similar to standing in a kiddie pool, probably filled with urine. I don't know why I threw that in there. When behind you is the ocean. And it seems to me that a lot of people's experience of bad religion is that they're not really going farther than dipping their toes in. They end where they should be beginning. They get to the answer when it's really just the start of a journey. So it is. It's like standing in a kiddie pool instead of swimming in the ocean. It's like sipping from a cup that has drawings of constellations on it and drinking out of a star cup instead of actually drinking in the night sky and looking up at the Milky Way or looking at pins of light that are suns a million times the size of our suns and the stars. It's more expansive. So to me, what I want to inspire us with or invite us into is the idea that reconstructed faith is more expansive, it's deeper, it's more beautiful than we could ever imagine, and there isn't any way to contain that. And the reason I brought up the Bible is because that's what we see in the Bible. You might, in Christianity, get the impression that it is actually simple. It's an equation. It's transactional. I actually made the mistake of Wikipediaing what is the purpose of Christianity, and it popped up in Google from Wikipedia. Basically, Christianity is, if you accept the death and resurrection of Jesus, you'll be offered eternal life. I'm not saying that that's not true, but that's a grossly, overly simplistic picture of something as big as a deep ocean or an expanding universe. And so what I was thinking of is how to illustrate that. Well, what do we actually find in the Bible if not that Wikipedia entry? Actually, we don't find that at all. What we find is starting thinking about the life of Jesus, people who encountered Jesus. For example, I was thinking of the blind beggar in Luke 18 who cries out for Jesus, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus finally goes over to this blind beggar, an outcast of society, and says, "What do you want me to do for you?" This penetratingly beautiful question. And he says, "I want to see." And Jesus ultimately heals him and brings healing to his life, as Jesus tends to do. And you could take that story and say, is this the sum of Christianity? And I would say yes and no. Because it seems like every story in the life of Christ, every story from the Jewish scriptures, every part of church tradition is like a multiverse. It's like in and of itself, you could go deeper down each little rabbit hole, because that's a huge concept to say that I want to see and not be blind. How many people do we know in our life that they're not evil, they're just blind? They're good, but they just can't see. And we long for them to experience the universal Christ and to have their eyes opened. And I think through story after story of people who encounter Jesus, Zacchaeus in the very next chapter from the blind beggar, he encounters Jesus, and Jesus knows his name and then parties with him at his house. And then Zacchaeus says, "Today I give away half of all that I've taken." And Jesus says, "Salvation has come to this house today." So from that story, what do we say? Oh, salvation. Oh, the Bible says salvation is giving away a half of all that you have. Well, yes. And no, it's a new expanding universe that when Jesus encountered Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus needed an economic transformation. He needed to see, like the blind beggar, that he was extorting people and justice had to happen. And he needed relationship, Jesus to speak his name and to encounter him so that his life was transformed. And Jesus called that salvation. In the previous chapter also is the story of the rich young ruler who comes to Jesus and says, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And he says, "Why do you call me good? You know the commandments." I'm paraphrasing so much right now. This is very much drinking from a fire hydrant. And he says, "The one thing you lack, sell all that you own." So could we read that story and say that's what Christianity is? Well, yes and no. It has this component that says if there's something you won't let go of, then you're not really in the deep waters. You're not really playing the symphony level music. You're not really keeping that barrier that people have. I think of John 4, the Samaritan woman, and the way she tried to play it safe and conceal her life, but Jesus could see through that. And then he offered her living water, streams of living water. What beautiful image that would flow out of us. Could we say that is the encapsulation of systematic theology, that for everyone, Samaritan women, it's a racial issue, it's a gender issue, they're offered living streams of water that can flow from them? Well, yes. And that's a whole new universe to explore within the Christian faith. But also, no, that doesn't encapsulate it all. It's just another universe to unfold in this deep well that we call faith or Christianity. I think a couple of chapters later, in John chapter 6, John 6:66, where all these disciples, when Jesus is talking about his flesh being real matter and flesh and his blood, you got to drink it and eat it. People understandably freaked out and left him. Following later in the chapter, he looks to his closest friends and says, "Do you want to leave me too?" And Peter says this crazy beautiful phrase, "To whom would we turn? You have the words of eternal life." And I like to translate ionos, which is often translated eternal. It has to do with time, but not necessarily eternal. So I like it to think of it an epic, like an epic of time. You have the words of epic life. Is that Christianity? Yes, but not all of it. Peter, you can trace him through the whole Gospels, a fisherman who owns a business and drops it all when he's offered a Harvard-level invitation to follow a rabbi, and he leaves it and he follows this rabbi. Peter, who is in a boat, terrified, in one of the most dramatic and crazy stories of the whole Gospel. They think that they see a ghost with Jesus walking on the lake. Everyone's scared, and what does Peter do? He says, "I want to do something incredible." And he asked Jesus if he can come out there too and be wrapped up into this epic life, this eternal life, this adventure of life. Is that the gospel? Yes, but not all of it. It's the story that draws us in. It's an invitation to drink from a deeper well, and a well that can overflow from love of God, receiving a love of God, loving God, and then pouring that love into other people, as Jesus says the main commandments are. I think of Peter having some negative experiences. I think of the night where Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the soldiers come, and Peter draws his sword. And Jesus scolds him and tells him to put the sword away. He says that all who live by the sword will die by the sword. It's like he spent all these years following this Jewish rabbi in this education system, and he still thought the way of the world and violence was going to be the way. And Jesus says, "Put away your gun." And I did mean to say gun, because it's relevant. Your weapon of death is not the way. In fact, the way is only through death. Is that the gospel? Nonviolence? A critique of war and weaponry? Yes and no, because it's a really unbelievably deep story and well that touches people and as they interact with Christ or the divine, and it transforms them. And then Peter experiences the resurrection after denying Christ. Christ restores him and cooks him a breakfast on the beach. I think of the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts, who is a person of color, who is sexually different, who is denied at the temple, and then says, "What should keep me from being baptized?" And Philip says, "Nothing should keep you from being a part of this divine art that is sacrament. Come be a part of it." Is that the gospel? Is that the point? Yes, and not all of it. It's just too big. Why am I doing this? Why am I just vomiting these stories to you? Because these are the stories that pop into my head, whether it's Nicodemus coming at night and asking Jesus and being told about being born again and again and new life, or if it's about light and darkness in the words of Jesus, or turning water that's dirty water for cleansing into joy-filled wine. All of it has something to do with what it means to be a part of reconstructed faith. And I will not offer you a systematic way of understanding it. What I offer you is the invitation to come deeper into the well and the waters, to look farther into the expanding universe of faith, to listen longer to this epic millennia-old symphony of ideas about liberation and exile. I didn't even touch the Jewish scriptures about Jacob wrestling with the angel of the Lord or God himself, as the Talmud or the rabbis would say, in getting the name Israel, which means to struggle with God, that part of faith is wrestling with God. All of that is included in a reconstructed faith. But what I don't want to do is leave with you the impression that it's like putting together a simple bike. It's so much better than that. And I hope that this whole series has piqued curiosity. I hope it's like the tip of an iceberg. I hope that it's hopeful. I hope that in the midst of some of the pain of looking at the hard parts of where faith has gone bad, that we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater, that we remember that there's hope, that there's something calling us, something behind the beauty that we see in nature, something behind our numinous experiences with our children, our loved ones, ourselves, that calls us to something deeper. You know, when people say love is their religion, I think that's the beginning, like I said. And I also think the next question is, what is love? Some people think that they're loving when they abuse their children into forcing them into obey. That's not love. So how do we know? Well, in Christianity, we saw the face of love. And the incarnation, we can say, we know what love is because love taught us to love our enemies and to forgive 7 times 70 times, 490 times to forgive, and taught us how to pray. And that prayer is that the kingdom of God would come here on earth right now. And so it really doesn't matter ultimately what you believe. Contra what a lot of Christianity is, I'm not interested in converting you to believing the same things I believe. I think that it's almost like family. When you're in a family, you're in it, whether you have a bad family or a good family. And to try to sum up what a family is, it's impossible. You could say, oh, it's for safety and security. That's true, but that's not the whole thing. You could say it's about relational connections or economic security or emotional attachments, and all those things would be true, but it doesn't sum up what family is. And so whatever you believe or don't believe, whatever part of Christianity or not Christianity you're a part of, you're actually still bringing heaven and hell onto earth with love. And I think that in our faith, it's still as powerful today to follow this rabbi from 2,000 years ago, and it's not simple. There's no easy way of constructing it, but it is a really epic invitation to eternal life, to Zoe, this booming, bursting forth life. But for a so what today, since this whole thing is a so what, I thought I would do something different. I called some of the closest people to me, and I asked them to just very briefly share for them what's the point of Christianity. I thought it might be more powerful than me continuing to yap at you to do what the Bible does and just tell stories. So some of my friends are just going to share a little bit of what the point of their faith journey is. I hope you enjoy.
Hey, Commons family. So my own reconstruction experience has really shifted me from a place of needing to be right and have all of the answers to finding rest and just being able to be in awe of the mystery of our faith. I think the earlier construct of my own faith really was maybe motivated by fear and needing to be right. And so the more I learn and the more that I doubt and wrestle and see that that's a beautiful thing and really encouraged by our community, the more I feel like that's become a big part of what's the point for me, is kind of the wrestle and the questions themselves. The bigger part of that, though, for me has been in the letting go of needing to be right and having all the right answers. I feel like the one thing that remains is Christ's love. And the more I learn about God and Christ and the person of Jesus, the more I see how profoundly and deeply each of us is loved. And I especially see that in our community and the people around us being the hands and feet of Jesus to our community and those around us. And I think that that outpouring of Christ's love is really what has kept me tethered to following Jesus and to being part of a Christian community. It gives me great hope, especially in uncertain times, which is a lot like now. This feels like a very uncertain time. But it gives me great hope in seeing that love is an action and it's being displayed within our community. It gives me hope in the verse Colossians 1:19-20 that all fullness is found in him. Through him, all things are reconciled, everything in heaven and everything on earth.
Hey guys, so I think that why I follow Christianity specifically to me kind of changes throughout the different stages in my life. But one thing that has always remained constant is just being able to find peace and stillness and prayer, and just like knowing that you don't have to have the burden of everything all the time on just yourself. And I think that whether you're going through loss or grief or pain, or your life is looking different than how it normally looks, it can be kind of hard to find the point and kind of put that trust in something else. I have a lot of issues kind of like losing the control, and I always think that I can just take on everything and like control everything myself, especially when it comes to hardship and things like that. But I think there's a lot of power in being able to be in a community that believes the same thing, that's there for you, and following Jesus and just kind of learning different perspectives of how other people have gone through things, and being able to take that into your own life and become better because of that. So, yeah.
Hey, everybody. Sorry if you hear my kids screaming in the background. They're outside right now. So, for me, the answer to what is the point is multifaceted and kind of ever-changing in my life. But I think for me, specifically around spirituality and church, the point is relationship. And it's relationship because I feel like as a human, the best parts of ourselves are revealed in relationship. It's messy and it's painful, but I think in some mysterious ways it is one of the highest forms of being human. And so I'm interested in that, I'm compelled by that, and I want to be a part of that in the church and or gathering. It doesn't have to be church, I think just being together and trying to interact with the divine are two places that I think that's the core of what it's about. So in some other mysterious way too, I think when I look outside and see nature or have a beautiful interaction with my wife Greta or my kids, there's just something in it that is divine, and I'm really interested in that and trying to interact with that, even though I feel like the title of it is changing and it's kind of ever dancing around my life. But I want to be in relationship with that thing. Even though, ironically, I'm not even sure what that thing is sometimes. But I wanted to read this poem to end my answer by Emily Dickinson, and it's called Why Do I Love You, Sir? And it's a poem that she wrote about why she loves God. So here it is. Why do I love you, sir? Because the wind does not require the grass to answer. Wherefore, when he passes, she cannot keep her place. So I think just like the poem is saying, you know, I feel I am that sprig of grass that is moved by God, and I can't necessarily articulate that, and I think that's okay, and I recognize that. So that is my answer.
That's definitely a question I've asked myself. What's the point of a relationship with Jesus, or what's the point of being a part of a church? And where I'm at right now, I'd say that the life of Jesus is just too compelling for me to ignore. The idea that God would put skin on and come down to us instead of us always trying to work our way up to God, that's a picture of humility that I'm really attracted to. The way that Jesus lived was just without borders. Eating meals with the social outcasts, turning the other cheek, washing his friends' dirty feet. I think following that example makes me love others better, and it makes me love myself more fully. It helps me move towards becoming the best version of myself. As my faith has changed over the years, God has just become more tangible, more big. It's not about who's in or who's out, or trying to make people think like I think. It's about seeing God in everyone and in everything, and learning from people who are different than me. I had to take God out of this little box I had put it in and see how much deeper and bigger it truly was. So what's the point? Well, for me, when I'm in a secure place where I know that I'm loved and I'm learning from the life of Jesus how to love others better, I think there's a purpose in that. And then when we come together collectively and experience that, we can see more of heaven on earth, more inclusivity, more generosity, more peace. That's something worth pursuing.
I'm so thankful for all of them being vulnerable and sharing their story. I hope that the power of their story spoke to your heart, and I hope it served as an invitation to go farther in. C.S. Lewis has this beautiful image of just going farther in and deeper in into the heaven, and that's heaven on earth. And to me, it's faith. It's a journey. Faith is jumping out of an airplane. It's bungee jumping. It's gingerly, fearfully walking on a wall. It's an action that we do, and it needs more language for us to talk about. It needs more community. It needs more wrestling with stuff, and that's what excites me about it. That's why I love all of you. I love learning from you. I love hearing your stories. I love standing at the precipice of death with you, and marriage and love and baptism and communion, the sacraments of the faith, because we share life together. And I think it is eternal in a very transcendent way. And I think it is epic. So what we're going to do to close our time today is share communion, that sacrament. Go grab something from the kitchen if you want, or prepare yourself. I believe that God, certainly love, certainly transcends space and time, and we can be connected even in the sacrament in this social distancing time. So I'm going to pray over the elements, and we're going to take into us the mystery of this big, big story. I mean, even something as small and simple as communion is so much deeper. I've probably taken communion hundreds of times in my life, and it's always deeper. There's always a new thing that sticks out to me about the wine of joy, the blood of Christ, the forgiveness, the grace, the connection to us as a family. I hope that the artful practice of this will bind our hearts one to the other. Let me pray over these elements, and we'll share them together and listen to some beautiful music. Lord, thank you so much for the Commons and this family, and every single beloved daughter and son that represents, that we have the privilege of knowing each other and being a part of a family. And Lord, we confess to you at this table, this big, open, beautiful feast of a table that you talk so much about in your incarnation, Lord. We ask you to forgive us for our personal mistakes that hurt us and other people. And in receiving you today, we receive that forgiveness. We ask you to forgive us of our corporate mistakes as a family, as a community, as a nation, as a species, Lord. Forgive us of those things that hurt your beloved, and help us to repent or change our mind, to go deeper down the journey of becoming more like love and more like you. Thank you for grace. Thank you for hope. Thank you for stories. Thank you for universes and universes and deep, deep wells that is faith. I pray, God, that all of us will be inspired with your spirit in us, that we'll be moved to know you more, to be known more by you, and to let that love flow like streams of living water to all around us. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, no.
like losing my religion, trying to keep up with you, and I don't know if I can do it. Oh no, I've said too much, I haven't said enough.
Hey Commons family, it's Liz. Just wanted to let you know what I've been enjoying at the end of my week and the end of my day, and that has been getting outside, exploring trails around my house, breathing in the fresh air, getting some sunshine. It's definitely been the highlight of my day and my weeks. I look forward to the time we can all be together. Miss you guys. Hope to see you soon.
Hi Commons family. Something I look forward to every week is getting outside and riding my bike.
Hi everyone, my name's Chad and I'm here to tell you about this Wednesday's Fill the Truck event at noon at the Commons office. We're going to be again partnering with the Northern Arizona Interfaith Council and helping our undocumented friends within the Flagstaff community. During the economic downturn caused by COVID-19, our undocumented friends, many have been hit especially hard as they're not eligible for stimulus funds or unemployment. So this is an opportunity to help those families by donating food and other supplies at the Fill the Truck event. Or if you're unable to stop by, you can also donate on Venmo to the Commons, and we can certainly do some shopping for you and get some supplies and food to help donate to these families in need.